You are listening to Influencers from the Conference Board.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Influencers, a podcast from the Marketing and Communications Center here at the Conference Board. My name is JP Kuehlwein, and I'm the leader of the Marketing and Communications Institutes. Today, I'll be talking to Sangeet Paul Choudary about the business of platforms and platforms as brands. Now, platform businesses are all over the business news. Some of them have grown very fast over the past decade or even less and become dominant in diverse industries like transportation. Just think of Uber, hospitality, Airbnb, social media, Facebook, entertainment, Apple with its iTunes, knowledge management, Google, or retail, Amazon, and so forth. These companies are among the most valuable in the world by now, and thousands of startups try to replicate their feat in other areas. Which poses obviously the question, what are traditional manufacturers and service providers to do to try and compete with these emerging titans? I have the distinct honor and pleasure to interview Sangeet Paul Choudary on the subject for today. Sangeet, welcome to the program.
Thank you, JP. It's a pleasure to be on the program.
Sangeet is highly qualified to talk to us about this. He's a consultant on the subject. He's an entrepreneur in residence at the renowned INSEAD Business School. He's a fellow at the Center for Global Enterprise, and he has co-authored what I would call the Bible on how platforms work. It's entitled Platform Revolution, was published in 2017, and he did it together with professors Geoffrey Parker of Dartmouth and Professor Marshall von Alstyne at Boston College. Both are also researchers on digital economy at MIT. So definitely an in-depth look at platforms and the digital economy more broadly. Sangeet is continuing to extend this research on platforms. We'll talk about that. He's consulting with companies both on how to build platforms or how to compete with platforms and with countries, and we'll hear a little bit about that as well. So this will be very much our subject. Sangeet, welcome again. Why don't we start by you telling us a little bit about your background and work, particularly as it relates to platforms and their business? What is so fascinating about that?
Yeah, so I first got fascinated with platforms around 2006-2007, way before this became the rage, as you would say. And back around that time, I was working on an investment in Alibaba, and I could see what was so interesting and unique about Alibaba as a business. And so I started that kind of piqued my interest, and I figured that there was fundamentally a different way to think about value creation on the internet, that digital technologies and the internet essentially enable the creation of entirely new markets of value creation and value exchange. And so that initial idea was what kind of fascinated me. And then around the 2008-2009 mark, I started seeing companies like Uber, Airbnb coming up, and a lot of that started making sense. So I got into it full-time around the 2011 mark, early 2012. And initially, when I started talking about it, people did not understand the difference. They thought this was about ride-hailing, or this was about the sharing economy, or maybe about social networks. But they could not see there was a much bigger shift afoot with this whole idea of platforms. So I had to explain what exactly this was. And so to explain that, I coined the term pipelines to contrast platforms with traditional companies which work more linearly like pipelines. They produce and they ship. What's so fascinating about platforms is that platforms do not rely only on the internal resources. They do not rely only on the internal labor. They rely on the resources, the intellectual property and the labor of external parties, and figure out a mechanism to harness all of that for their own business model. And so if you look at the Apple App Store, that's using the intellectual property of third-party developers. If you look at Uber, it's using the labor of third-party drivers. And if you look at Amazon, it's using the resources of third-party merchants. So platforms, fundamentally what's fascinating about them is their ability to leverage resources, labor, and IP that is outside their organization boundaries.
Right. And having read your book, I mean, it becomes clear that compared to what you call the pipeline companies that kind of, in fact, try as much as they can to control production almost from the primary ingredient all the way to getting it into stores, sometimes wanting to own the stores as well, these platforms are often neither the producers nor the owners or sellers of what is being provided, whether that's a physical product or a service. That's all often done by others. So, in fact, they're just coordinating and allowing the flow of data. Am I summarizing this somewhat right?
Yeah, that is largely correct, because the reason the flow of data is so important is that you need to understand what these resources are externally. So you need to understand, for example, the quality of a product being sold by a merchant on Amazon, or the experience of a hotel on a hotel booking platform. So you need to understand information about the external resources, and you need to understand what customers are looking for, consumers are looking for, and that's how you match the two. And that's why the role of data is so important. What I would call out is that while all platforms leverage the resources that are external to the firm, the presence of internal assets or internal resources does not disqualify something from being a platform. Very often, it actually makes sense to own the most important resources and assets. So if you think of Amazon as an example again, it always chooses to be the retailer in the most important categories. And it chooses to own the warehousing network, because if it doesn't own the warehousing network, it cannot guarantee two-day delivery to consumers using Prime. And if it cannot guarantee that two-day delivery, it cannot engage and lock in the consumers, and then its control over the platform goes down. And so it's important that even as you use data and you use external resources, you also identify what are the specific points at which you need to exercise ownership as a platform business.
Interesting. Now, there's also a lot of talk about another aspect that seems unique to platforms, which is the famous network effect, and which in fact seems so critical to gain scale, the required scale for platforms to work, but also for platforms to become these formidable competitors. Can you talk to us a little bit about what the network effect is?
Right. So the idea of the network effect is that the value of a utility grows as the number of users around it increase. Now, if you look at traditional products, if you look at a bar of soap or, you know, literally any product that you have, a consumer electronics product in the traditional world, none of those things had this relationship with usage. So my TV does not become more useful as other more users apart from me start using that TV. But in the traditional world, we had things like the telephone. The telephone becomes more useful as more people are connected to the telephone. Now, when you bring this to the world of platforms, we see two types of network effects. One is the telephone-style network effect, which is called a direct or one-sided network effect, where other users like me using that particular platform increase the value of the platform. So if you think of WhatsApp, the more of my friends and people I know use WhatsApp, the more valuable it becomes. But the other often more important network effect is the two-sided network effect, where you have producers of value and consumers of value. And the more producers come, the more consumers will come. So if you think of YouTube, the more people produce videos, the more people will watch them. And the more viewers they are, the more videos will get produced. Or if you think of the Apple App Store, the more applications are created, the more the iPhone becomes valuable. And the more people buy the iPhone, the more developers want to come and create new applications. So that's the key distinction.
So it promises really exponential growth, kind of the tipping point effect. I wonder, do you observe with platforms that they also more naturally grow into broader networks themselves? What I mean with that is, if I look at Airbnb, at the beginning it was about rooms and people who want to kind of rent rooms, then quite naturally they accumulated so much information that they almost got into the travel journalism business. They now have a magazine and so on, and I guess they could easily have a fantastic blog on travel. They also spawned out into experiences, which was quite natural to add experiences. And now there's talk that they'll also get into transportation and other. And there's a whole cottage industry now supplying Airbnb, like cleaning services, maintenance services, insurance, that they could harness. Does this kind of branching out almost organically somehow happen faster also on platforms because of these network and growth effects? Or do you think this is more or less in line with pipeline businesses? The same happens there.
Yeah, so we do see pipeline businesses also branching out. But there's one significant difference when it comes to platform businesses. Pipeline businesses very often branch out because they are able to leverage the same asset base that they had and are able to amortize their costs across a larger set of businesses. And so it makes sense for them to branch out into new businesses. On platforms, it's a little different. On platforms, what happens is that platforms capture data and platforms capture the engagement of users to such an extent that using the data, they are able to move the users to related adjacent interactions. So if you look at a whole range of different examples over here, if you look at, you know, the simplest example being Uber, the fact that you have this whole fleet of drivers and you have these users who are engaged, you are able to not just move users now or passengers, you can also move food on top of this network. If you take that a step further and look at Facebook, the fact that users are interacting can now mean that brands can also start interacting with users, which then makes this a brand engagement mechanism. And from there, you could go into other kinds of branding and brand promotion capabilities. And so those are all extensions that are coming along this around this initial aim of just helping users to connect with friends. Similarly, what you're talking about Airbnb, there's always the starting point with platforms. And once you gain traction around that initial code interaction, which is that initial use case that is being enabled, you can then start moving into a whole range of adjacent use cases, largely because you understand the user enough using their data and because the user is heavily engaged in your ecosystem. So that's the difference. When pipelines move, they move from more of a resource perspective, while platforms move more from a user perspective.
Whereas with the classic traditional pipeline manufacturer, it's more about physical asset utilization or maybe the expertise linked to that manufacturing process. With platforms, it's more about mastering and harnessing all the data that they accumulate on the interactions that happen on their platform and on the profiles of all the participants, if I understand that right.
That's correct. And as you know, we hear the term customer centricity. As more and more businesses become customer centric, even pipeline businesses will start thinking like this, because they will start attracting user data. They will be able to move better into adjacencies that serve the user rather than serve their asset base.
Right. But increasingly nowadays, there is also a discussion around what might be the potential downsides of this fast growth network effect. And that is some kind of monopolistic DNA that seems to reside in platforms, in the sense that they all rush to become the biggest and kind of omnipresent and all-encompassing platforms, whether it's Alibaba or Amazon in terms of what you shop, or it's, you know, Spotify in terms of what you listen to, et cetera, et cetera. Is that an ingrained, unique feature of platforms that they have this tendency to become monopolies if they want to succeed? Or is that no different from, you know, the initial industrial revolution and, you know, the robber barons trying to own oil or the railway, et cetera?
Yeah, so it is quite similar to what used to happen back during the era of the robber barons. What is different this time around is that instead of acquiring new oil fields and new steel mills, you are now looking at acquiring the largest ecosystems of users and partners. So what is different is that the rate at which you are able to gain monopoly is much faster. If you look at the companies that are global monopolies today, most of them are less than 20 years old, and they've been able to they've succeeded in becoming the largest companies in the world in less than 20 years, some of them in less than 10 years. And the reason for that is the network effect, the fact that you are not inhibited by your internal resources in order to become the number one player. The resources are coming from outside, from the ecosystem, and so as long as you are able to engage the ecosystem, provide them the right reasons for participation, you have a shot at becoming this large monopolistic power. And once you become the monopoly, then the negotiating power obviously moves in your direction. It moves away from the ecosystem. So what happens very often is that platforms have a bait and switch model. They bait users in with a very with good incentives, with a lot of subsidization, but over time they start changing their policies once the network effect sets in and users get locked in. So we see that happen very often.
So in one word, they are formidable competitors, emerging competitors. So the big question, obviously, probably for 90% of the people who will listen to this podcast is, you know, see, I'm a traditional manufacturer or a service provider. What can we do to compete with this new animal in the market with these platforms? Have you gathered some success stories from very classic former pipeline businesses that are able to counter these competitors?
Right. So I do this all the time because most of my clients are actually traditional large firms, which have been around for much longer than many of these platform businesses. And what's important over here is to first understand your value chain and understand which parts of the value chain are going to get impacted by platforms, and accordingly, where should you try to be a platform? Where is it too late to become a platform? And where should you try to partner with platforms? So you need to have a comprehensive strategy when you see your industry moving towards the platform model. Wherever you can become a platform, you should try to move in the direction of becoming a platform. In other places, you should look at partnering with platforms. And then there are a whole range of issues over there in terms of how do you avoid commoditization when you partner, how can you become an indispensable partner and gain more power in the relationship. So that's a whole set of issues that we can get into some other time. But let me take a few tangible, real examples to wrap our heads around. So I'll take a couple of examples over here. One of the best examples is a Norwegian company called Schibsted Media Group, which is the world's largest traditional media company in terms of share, in terms of the shift to platform business models. Today, they make 80% of their revenues from platform business models. And this happened because 20 years back, when they started seeing Google Google gain power, they shed their media assets. They divested a lot of the media assets. They stopped focusing on advertising as a business model, and they shifted their focus onto classifieds, and eventually converted the classifieds into marketplaces, and eventually into a single platform business. And so today they are the world's largest success story in the media industry of a traditional company that has shifted to a platform business model. Another one closer home is Walgreens, the pharmacy in the US, right? So if you look at Walgreens, it still has the traditional pharmacy business, but it's complemented that with the platform business, where if you join the Walgreens Benefit Rewards program, which is the loyalty program, you become your interactions with Walgreens becomes digitized. So they start getting data about what medicines you're buying, but then you can connect third-party applications, like a fitness application, something that where you're tracking, you're running on a daily basis. You can connect those applications to the Walgreens the rewards benefit rewards program, and for the actions that you do on this third-party application, you get points on the Walgreens loyalty program. And through this, Walgreens has succeeded in getting users to make more than a million integrations till date, and there are a total of around 100 million active users on the platform 5 years in. So they've been fairly successful from all of those, with all those parameters in mind. So these are some examples of traditional companies that have done it very successfully.
Yeah, and I studied one platform which started initially in Australia by an insurance company called Discovery that has the Vitality program that is now being licensed all throughout the world, in Asia, Singapore, in Europe, Germany, Italy, France, UK, and so on, but also in the United States through Hancock and other insurance companies. And they are very similar to what you described for Walgreens.
That's correct. That's correct.
They collect data, and basically they say our unifying purpose as an insurance company is actually to keep you, the insured, healthy. We have a win-win. The longer you live, the longer you pay premiums. So we have as much an interest in keeping you healthy as you have. And people literally buy into that, providing their data and for healthy activities that the insurance company recommends to them. If they fulfill these activities, they have a choice of rewards, et cetera, et cetera. And they have a ton of partners. So again, this is where the platform comes in, where they work with Nike, and then they work with Apple, and you get a free Apple Watch to track your activities, and you can redeem your points for Adidas items or to go to a Starbucks if that fits your health regimen, and so on and so on. Which brings me to another aspect that obviously is of much interest to this center, which is about marketing and communication, which is platforms as brands, as powerful, desirable brands. It seems to me that we've seen an arc here where at the beginning it was all excitement. Platform brands could do nothing wrong, whether it was the Googles or the Ubers, etc. They promised kind of limo service to everyone, you know, kind of limo democratization. Google has still the slogan of do no bad. Amazon was fantastic in delivering everything to your doorstep within a few days. But now it seems we're coming over a hump and there seems to be almost a backlash. We see people demonstrating against Uber. We see people upset about what happens to their data, whether it's with Amazon Alexa or Google. Have you seen ways, or have you seen platforms that have done a better job at continuing to being liked, desired, people wanting to work with them, versus these platforms that seem to be suffering from a certain level of backlash now, like Facebook?
Yeah, so there are several factors that determine whether a platform is going to receive some level of backlash. And to a large extent, this gets determined by whether the platform is enabling its producers, enabling its ecosystem to grow on top of it, or whether the platform is controlling access to the market for the ecosystem. And many platforms do both. You could argue that many platforms do both. But if you take some platforms like, say, Shopify, which allows anybody to set up a shop, now this, it just provides the tools on which you can set up your shop and you grow on top of Shopify. So everybody likes the platform, and until the platform comes in and starts controlling market access, the merchants do not really have any issue with that. But most other platforms that control the market access, the ones that you're talking about, and especially those that play with consumer data, once they become larger than a certain size, and once they have that level of monopolistic control and almost lock in the users and the producers in different ways, at that point they can do a lot of things that are detrimental to the users and the merchants without risking them leaving the platform. And that is when this becomes a problem. So back to your question about are there platforms that people like? The thing is that till a certain size where these platforms do not gain that level of negotiation advantage, the ecosystem typically likes the platform. Even if you look at even for the large platforms, you'll see that many of the larger platforms favor one side over the other. So if you look at Uber always favors the rider over the driver. The driver is seen as a commodity. And so even if there's a dispute that comes up, it very often gets settled in the favor of the rider. And so it's also important to know that platforms are very often asymmetrical. Even Amazon favors the user over the merchant. And so in all these large platforms as well, there will often be one party that is happy with the platform and the other party that is not. But it is the party that is more difficult to gain access to and more difficult to retain, which will be better served by the platform. And that happens all the time. That's the nature of platform markets.
But it seems to me that for platforms to succeed and kind of keep their leading position long term, they need to figure a way to keep everyone, if not most people, happy, i.e. their organization, their own platform organization, their producers, and their buyers. And it seems to me that some of the key ingredients and outcomes of platforms, like their very participatory nature, you know, you work together at Airbnb, being a host, being a guest, you need to figure it out together. The very personalization, the personalization of products that's going on through the huge choice and through, you know, being able to kind of craft exactly what you want, they would have an opportunity to be very strong brands. Because when you look at the strongest classic brands around, personalization, participation, and the feeling of belonging, having a shared purpose, for example, you know, with Airbnb talking about belonging everywhere, which has elements of, you know, encouraging to travel, diversity, world peace, if you like. Those are all elements that are very desirable for brands. It's what a lot of the traditional brands are moving to, having a purpose, sharing it, creating these groups, these movements and belonging. So the ingredients are there. It seems to me that what platforms need to be aware of as a business model is to not succumb to the incredible temptation to kind of monopolize the power of the data and to use it uniquely for themselves, i.e. to sell ads or to sell data for other purposes. Does that make sense from what you observe?
Yeah, so I think it's a natural it's a natural consequence of any business that gains too much power over the ecosystem. So the reason I say that is if you look at B2B platforms, which we don't see very often, you know, when we're looking at Facebook, Amazon, and Google, but you look at companies like GE, Schneider Electric, Siemens, which are building B2B platforms, it's much more difficult for them to act against the interest of their partners because those partners also have huge negotiating power. But when you look at B2C platforms, the merchants, the consumers, the partners are all so much smaller than the platform that once the platform gains monopolistic status, it becomes it's natural for them to start extracting more and more out of their business model. Now, the challenge over here is that not all platform businesses are the same. So you keep mentioning Airbnb. The reason Airbnb is different from Uber is if you look at Airbnb versus Uber, if you look at this in general and platforms, when a platform needs its partners and partners bring unique experiences, unique products to the platform, then the platform creates the right incentives to serve its partners well. Now, the difference between Airbnb and Uber is that on Uber, what a driver brings to the platform, the ability to go from point A to point B, is a commodity, which is why you don't really care which driver takes you from point A to point B. Uber decides which driver should be served to you. But on Airbnb, every unique listing is a unique experience. And so you have to decide, the host has to project themselves. And so the power of who is transacting with whom and how they transact shifts back to the host and the user. And so the key point over here is that the more commoditized the service or product delivered, the more the platform wants to act like a monopoly. The second piece that we see repeatedly is that the larger the platform is compared to every other party in the ecosystem, the more the platform will act like a monopoly. So when looking at antitrust and when looking at platform markets, these are the kinds of factors, more architectural and design factors that you need to look for to see whether the platform will behave even at scale in a manner that is valuable to the ecosystem or works against their interests.
That's very interesting. And I'm thinking of another transportation platform, which is French-founded, BlaBlaCar. There it's about long-distance drives. And it seems to me that we see a little bit in the, it's a little bit in the middle between Uber and Airbnb in that what I hear from participants is that since you're sitting in the car for very long, and it's more of a shared experience, literally, where conversations are being built and so on and so on. The choice of driver and what they offer and of passenger is more important. And it's a little bit more of a quote-unquote love mark. It's a little bit more of a relational offering. And there may be a little bit more of brand building that's important, building into trust, etc. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that is correct. That is correct. And so eventually it comes down to just one simple distinction. Is the platform enabling the long tail, which is it encouraging variety? Is it encouraging choice? Is it encouraging, different options? Or is the platform just facilitating commodity exchange? So if you think of Airbnb, it's, Airbnb is the long tail. Uber is a commodity exchange.
Gotcha. Turning a little bit to organization, and we'll talk financials also in a second. Airbnb seems to be discussing ways to make Airbnb hosts automatic part owners of Airbnb. So to make it almost like a little bit of a mutual company where every host owns a small share of Airbnb, and the more they host, the more they own. Would you see this also as a organizational means to get everyone a stake and kind of skin in the game, and thus to almost warrant that it's more engaging and remains a more interesting brand with more interesting offers versus the more commoditized utilitarian Uber? What do you think about this potential move?
In terms of co-ownership, that's where you're referring to?
Yes. Do you think it's good, or do you think it's a distraction as far as the growth and the power of this platform goes?
Right. So we've seen this before. We've seen this with platforms like Stocksy. Stocksy is a platform much like Shutterstock in the sense that it helps you find stock photos by photographers. So it connects photographers with users. And Stocksy provides a certain percentage ownership in the platform to its photographers. So in that case, it's worked quite well because the photographer community tends to be very, tends to be fairly homogeneous, tends to be a close-knit community. When you have that community on the producer side, co-ownership may often work well. Co-ownership does not necessarily scale very well beyond a point because the value of the co-ownership starts going down as the platform scales beyond a point. So I've seen co-ownership work extremely well for really, really small markets. It's worked very well for labor markets in Denmark, where the labor unions tried to create an alternative to Uber. It's worked really well in France, where platforms have been built, almost modeled as cooperatives to model the town marketplace. Actually, the actual fresh produce market is now being modeled on platforms. And in all these cases, because it's a close community, it's a small number of users, the co-ownership works very well. I've not seen it work at Airbnb scale yet. So we'll have to see how well that plays out. I've seen it works really well at small numbers, and it makes sense in terms of why it would work there. But we'll have to see if it works at the scale that Airbnb is trying to implement it at.
That makes sense. I'm reminded of a classic pipeline business in the financials industry, Vanguard Investments, which is a mutual investment company, in the sense that all the mutual fund owners are also owners of the company itself. And again, it's a huge company, obviously $4 trillion under management. And so the ownership part is minute. But it seems to me that just from a philosophy perspective, this kind of, you own it. So since you're the owners, we act in your interest. We have no other shareholders or owners to report to. It seems very strong for a certain segment of investors, a convincing argument to buy into their mutual fund that rather than anyone else's that are owned by private people or by stockholding companies. It could be that it can work out this way as well for companies like Airbnb, I guess.
Yeah, we'll have to see if it works at scale, but yes.
Right. Staying in organization for a second, I just wondered, in observing platforms versus pipeline organizations, any very significant differences that particular classic players have to take into account when they consider maybe transforming themselves partially or fully into a pipeline? What might be different as an organization of a platform versus a pipeline?
Right. So most pipeline businesses, this is something that I see every time I work with a traditional business, most pipeline businesses were built along silos because they were built along product verticals, and those verticals did not have to necessarily work together. So they would have some shared common services, but those were all support services. The business units themselves are silos. In platform businesses, we need to have, we need to restructure this in terms of an internal ecosystem so that every business unit has the appropriate interface and protocols to communicate internally with every other business unit. Now, that could be in terms of processes. More importantly, if you look at how Amazon transformed themselves back in 2002, this could also mean in terms of internal APIs. Even though you have different business units, they publish APIs internally so that the technology between that enables each of these businesses is able to communicate internally. And when you're a platform business, you constantly try to see how you can create a single view of the ecosystem internally so that every business unit has the same view of the external user, has the same view of the external partner. Again, in a pipeline business, that did not always happen. You would have different business units, and all of them would see would serve the same user without knowing it. Now, the best example to understand this is, again, if I take the example of Schibsted Media Group, they had a massive transformation around 2014, 2015, where they did exactly this. They worked across their business units and created a common data profile across all of these business units, and then centralized a lot of the technology stack so that every business unit was using the same technology stack. So they centralized and they created a central part of the organization, which was almost like a standard setting body. It would set standards for every other part of the organization to use, and then every other part of the organization would use those standards to work with those API definitions to then build on top of it. So that's the kind of coordination you need to have internally, both organizationally and technologically, if you are to enable an ecosystem outside.
What about the quite unique financial, it seems, as well, that you have on platforms? You were talking already about kind of subsidizing one side of the platform marketplace, or maybe even both sides. We hear about Uber, for example, charging less than it actually costs to take a ride, so that the riders are multiplying and are delighted, at least for the time being. But the drivers are suffering. Nevertheless, even with their IPO, you know, they're making huge losses huge losses, and are still being invested into? How should a classic finance person considering platforms look at that? I mean, I would think many of them scratch their heads. What's going on? How sustainable is that from every perspective financially? How are you looking at that? Is it right what Uber is doing? I mean, even Amazon is not tremendously profitable, but we understand it's by choice because they reinvest so much into growth, and they could choose to be very profitable. Can you explain that a little bit to us?
Yes. So I'll take both these examples because I'm a big fan of one and a big critic of the other. And there's a reason why that is the case. So I'm not a big fan of Uber for a simple reason. When you are looking at the financials of a platform business, the one question you need to ask yourself is, yes, it has a network effect, but how defensible is the network effect? Can it be copied or is it non-copyable? Now, if you look at Uber, the network effect is not defensible at all because I can have both Uber and Lyft and any other app on my phone, and the driver can have two or three phones and have all of these apps running simultaneously. So both of us can participate on multiple platforms at the same time, and there's nothing holding us to one platform. But if you look at Amazon, if I've signed up for Amazon Prime, it is highly unlikely that I'm going to sign up for another two-day delivery solution by Walmart or Target. It's highly unlikely that I'll do that. So that network effect is very defensible. On the other side, on the merchant side, Amazon has a price matching algorithm, which determines whether the price at which the merchant is selling on Amazon is higher than anywhere else on the internet. And if it is, it requires the merchant to bring down its price. So the merchant will always sell at the lowest price. The consumer will always get the lowest price. And so the network effect is very defensible because you just don't get a better deal somewhere else. Now, because of these, this is the key factor you need to look at. And that is why when you look at Uber, you'll see that Uber has repeatedly been beaten in markets like China, Southeast Asia, India. It's repeatedly suffered a loss and has had to pull out of many of these markets because the network effect is not defensible. And in all these markets, the competitor has been able to gain ground. And the difference between Uber versus Facebook versus Amazon is that in the case of Uber, you're not investing in a network effect. You're just seeing who can burn money faster and who stays on longer. So who has deeper pockets and burns money for a much longer time. And whoever is the last person standing wins. That's what happened in China. That's what happened in Southeast Asia. That, to some extent, is how I believe Lyft versus Uber will play out in the long run. I don't see both of them being very feasible businesses operating in the same cities at capacity in the long run. Amazon is very different because if you want to be a retailer, you have to have control of the end user. And with control of the end user, you can have a very defensible network effect. So Prime allows Amazon to have the defensible network effect. Now, the reason Prime is so difficult to copy is because to guarantee two-day delivery, you need to ensure that your warehousing network is large enough to be within a two-day distance of the user. And that means that you have to keep investing in that warehousing. You have to, if you're starting out, you have to build out that kind of warehousing network. The scale at which Amazon has built that warehouse network today, it's impossible for somebody else to copy it. Walmart has that kind of warehousing network, but it has that depth in very different parts of the country where Amazon would initially not have entered. So to some extent, they have worked in fairly complementary markets. So apart from Walmart, I don't see anybody else who has that warehousing depth. But if you then combine Amazon's data capabilities, Amazon's new ability to engage the user, not just through its digital interfaces, but also through voice, all of those things start adding up. And the biggest thing in Amazon's favor is that Amazon is able to subsidize all of this through a high margin, highly scalable business called Amazon Web Services, which no other retailer has. And because no other retailer has it, they are not, they cannot really compete with Amazon on this particular piece. And so what's really important is when you're a financial analyst, you have to ask yourself, what is driving the network effect? That is what you have to value. That's where the valuation has to come in. So I don't agree, and I've never agreed with Uber's valuation for that simple reason.
Right. So it looks like it's a combination of the good old creating a competitive moat. You're talking about Prime, but it's also this unique aspect of gaining scale, gaining it fast, harnessing it, the warehouse network. like you said, owning the important key assets while leaving kind of production and buying to the general marketplace, but harnessing the data. It's quite an intricate system that builds up there. Very interesting. But it also, we've talked about it already a couple of times or touched on it. It also calls in the government because increasingly they're looking at this. They're looking at this cross-subsidization of business. They're looking at these formidable monopolistic buildup of networks. I understand one of your latest areas of fascination and research is to look at governments and both sides, kind of help them be platforms themselves, as well as look at how to deal with overly powerful platforms. We only have a minute or two left, but if you could just touch on what you're talking about there, and then maybe we can link to your website or other sources where people who are interested in all of these aspects of platform business could find out more.
Yeah, so I'll keep this part short. In terms of government, the key elements that the key role that the government plays is in terms of providing public digital utilities. And if you'd like to learn more about it, look at the India Stack, which is what's happening in India. It is the most prominent government-based platform strategy anywhere in the world. And the government, instead of trying to own and control platforms, provides these digital utilities on top of which other platforms can be built. So what's happening globally, where I work with governments, is helping them understand what role do they play and where do they enable the private sector to play a role, and so what kind of digital utilities should they be providing. The second piece is around antitrust, and over there it just comes down to a simple issue, which is what are the design choices that kind of point to a platform potentially exploiting its ecosystem in the future versus not. And I gave you one design choice, which was commodified versus differentiated suppliers on the platform. But there are many other such design choices. So understanding those design choices is where governments need to look at it, because a lot of regulation today is very case-based. You create a case against Uber and you try to regulate on that case. And that does not help, because you are never looking at the underlying design choices. So you need to look at the underlying design choices and then regulate around that. So that's the key idea around the government's involvement in this.
Fascinating. Sangeet, we're out of time, but I'm sure there are quite a few listeners who want to keep engaged, maybe get in touch with yourself. Can you give us some pointers where you can be reached? And also, my understanding is you have a course, and exclusively for our listeners, they might access one of those for free. Is there a link we can put on the conference board site in the podcast notes to get to that?
Yes, sure. So I will provide a link to the course. The course has come out of a need in the market, because every time I would speak to CEOs, they would say, how do I help my whole organization understand this? So it's essentially a course to help the whole organization, based on your role, to understand how platforms impact you and what it could mean for your business and what you should do about it. So I'll provide a link for that, and I'll also provide directions to get access to it for free, to one of the demo courses. Apart from this, you could have a look at the books that I've written. There's a top-ranked HBR article that I've written, and my website is platformthinkinglabs.com. If you'd like to reach out to me, it's sangeet@platformthinkinglabs.com.
Excellent. Well, thanks so much again, Sangeet, for your time and your insights. I found it incredibly instructive. And thanks to all of you listeners. Again, check out our podcast notes. We'll drop all the links and some of the companies we mentioned in there if you want to follow up on that. If you like this content, please subscribe to Influencers or some of our other programs. You can find them all on conferenceboard.org/podcasts or on iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, and your favorite podcast player. And with that, I want to say again, thank you very much, Sangeet, And I hope you'll all be listening in next time as well. This is JP Kuehlwein from the Conference Board.
This has been Influencers from the Conference Board.